I want to show you the robots that I have built and that I have worked since, I don't know, 3 months ago. And one disclaimer, when I was starting with this, when I was submitting this talk, I had only one robot and it was based on Raspberry Pi, hence the title. I changed the title since then because I have now more robots and not all of them are Raspberry Pi based. But I'm sure, well, most of them are controlled with Python in some way. So let's start with the very first robot that I ever tried to build. This is Herbie. It's originally it was a beam robot, so a junk bot. It was supposed to be built from electronics scrap that you recovered and built. It's very simple. It just has an analog amplifier on it, and it's supposed to seek light, so it's supposed to go towards light. Unfortunately, I never managed to get it to work. I have one version of it that I can show you. It looks something like this. Looks something like this. It's very simple, two motors, an amplifier, and two light sensors. And let me just turn it on to show you what it does right now. It's not supposed to do that. Okay, I think it has a very weak battery, but basically it's supposed to go toward the light. Maybe. So that was a failure, and that set me back several years, and I decided to pause making robot and do some other things. And yeah, but we can use it as a pretext to talk about the sensors that your robot can have. By the way, do any one of you know what robots are? Who knows what a robot is? Hands up. Who can give me a definition? Okay.
Anything.
Maybe that's not a very useful definition. Anybody else? Okay.
It's a device which can follow the light.
Okay, that's on the other side of the spectrum. Maybe too specific. Anybody else want to try something? No? Okay, I don't have a definition either. Turns out even the people who write standards and who make those robots don't really have a good definition. I'm going to work with a device that has some sensors and use them to move around or move some parts of it in a feedback loop. But in this case, that makes your car a robot. So you are driving a robot to work every day. Anyways, you can have sensors. And those sensors, the sensors that you can use in a hobby project like this, you can have distance sensors, like light and light-based distance sensors or sonar-based. They are basically what you have in your car when you are when you are reversing. You can have position sensors. That should be accelerometer, not accelerometro. Sorry about that. A gyroscope, a GPS even, or a simple potentiometer pot or encoder that that gives you a position of a joint. You can have some sensors that check your environment, like temperature, ambient light, or I don't know, noise. And then how you can connect them? Because this is very important, actually. What protocol do you use for connecting them? And I have listed a number of protocols. I'm not going to read that out loud. Sorry, you can use that. And they also tell you how many pins they use on whatever device you connect them to, and how many wires do you need to actually pull through your house to connect them if you are not making a robot, or if you are making your house into a robot, like intelligent home. Anyways, the next robot, it's a walking robot. So this one has wheels. Well, not very large wheels, but anyways, it rolls on the ground. And those robots are kind of lame. I mean, you just need two motors and you are done. It's not very challenging. So I mostly build walking robots because that's so much more fun. And that lets me concentrate on the problems with walking and not on the problems with behavior on or sensors. For example, this robot has absolutely no sensors at all. It just walks forward. It's a very popular design called Bob. I didn't invent it. It has an Arduino. Well, you can look at it. Okay, it has an Arduino Uno, which is a huge board if you look at it from the perspective of a robot. And it uses some rechargeable batteries for power. I will switch it on. Okay, it works. It was built like in 2 hours or something like that. You can notice that it has humongous feet. That's for stability. Okay. So let's talk about walking and about stability. Most robots that you want to build, most walking robots that you want to build at home, if you are not Boston Dynamics, are statically stable robots. That means that they can stop at any point during their walking, they can stop and not fall down. Or they can walk at any speed. You don't have to walk fast to get the balance. And to do that, they always have to keep the center of gravity of their body within the area of support. The area of support is it's formally defined as the convex outline of all the feet that are on the ground, right? So if you have 2 feet on the ground, you just draw lines between them, and the convex area between them is the area of support. If you rise 1 foot, the area of support is just that 1 foot. And the trick is to keep your center of balance, center of gravity, over this area at all times. That's why it has to, like, you know, balance with its body. And all of the robots that I will show you do that, more or less. Okay. The next robot. This is actually what started it. It's called Kubik. It's quite big. This will take a moment. So
it's booting. It has a Raspberry Pi on board, so it will take a moment. It's admittedly, it's not a very good design. It's the very first robot I built, and I rebuilt it at least 4 times. And it's still not very good. I tried to rescue the design by adding stuff to it, and it grew pretty large and heavy. Oh, here it is. Hello, Kubik. So, you can move the body around, and you can rotate it like this. And if you move the body around and at the same time make steps with the feet, you actually walk forward. You can also go backwards. Or you can rotate. It's hard with... Actually, I have a second microphone for that. Yeah. So you can have basic navigation. Yeah. That's a slight problem with the fact that its legs are a little bit too long and the servos are a little bit too weak. So I'm going to... It's getting hot, actually, and I'm going to switch it off now. But you get the idea. It also has a speaker, so it should make some, portal noise, portal turret noises and stuff like that. And hello, I can see you. But I didn't get to do that. Inside of it, there is just a Raspberry Pi, a battery with charging cable. Okay, a voltage regulator and a servo controller. It's not very complicated. Okay, the Raspberry Pi also has a Wi-Fi dongle, so normally I control it by SSHing into it and actually running Python scripts directly on the Raspberry Pi. As you can see, the legs are moved by hobby what's called RC servos or hobby servos. They are commonly used in toys, in radio controlled toys, that's why RC. And I'm going to tell you several things about those servos, in case you want to build your own robot or something like that. The most important parameter that you need to consider when you are choosing a servo for your robot is the torque. It should be in some strange unit like newtons per kilogram meter or something like that. But normally the producers just tell you kilograms per centimeter. And that means if your robot has 4 kilograms per centimeter of torque, your servo has 4 kilograms of centimeter per centimeter of torque. That means that on a lever 1 centimeter long, it can rise and hold in the air 4 kilograms. And on a lever 2 centimeters long, it could rise and hold 2 kilograms. So it's like linear with the length of the lever. And you can see the lever here is quite long. That's why it's too weak to actually, sometimes it's too weak to properly walk. And there is also PWM signal that's pulse width modulation. That's how you tell the servo how to turn, what angle to turn to. And you don't usually have to deal with that because the servo libraries that you will use will do that for you. You have to consider how much current your servo is going to draw because they are power hungry. And that means that you need a battery large enough to power them. And producers rarely tell you. You have to measure. And then, so first you buy your servos, then you measure how much current they draw, then you buy your battery to match that. Forget about powering them from USB cable. USB cable gives you 500 milliamps of power. That's how a single servo draws. Okay, there are other things you have to look at, like the if the voltage is right, if it has the right speed, if it has dead band that is small enough. Dead band is how much you have to tell it to move for it to actually move, because it will ignore small differences. Yeah, you have to consider if you want metal gears inside and to have bearings inside, because if they are plastic, they are going to strip easily. And yeah, if they are analog or digital. The difference is that digital servos can be driven with a much higher frequency, so you can have much smoother movement. But those servos are pretty expensive. They are like $8 per piece. And most servos I use in other robots are the cheapest ones I could get, because I was rethinking my designs and decided this size is not very good for robots. Okay, two words about contraction of the leg. As you can see, this servo here, the middle one, I call it knee because it's kind of between the hip and the ankle, but it doesn't look really like a knee. Anyway, this servo has to carry the weight of your robot on it. So that's a lot of work. And even worse, if the leg is like this, it's pretty fine, right? The lever is not very long. But if the leg is outstretched, you need a much bigger torque to actually carry the robot. So you have to always consider that. As you can see, I didn't... I will talk about that with a different robot. So I started with this robot, and it got into a vicious cycle like this. So initially it has very small cheap servos on it, and it couldn't really work very well. The servos would get hot, so I would replace them, and then I would have to replace the battery, and so on, so on, so on. And I sunk a lot of money into this robot, just replacing parts with bigger ones and bigger and bigger. And then I decided, okay, no more. I will try with a different design that is not so hungry for the parts. A word about batteries. The alkaline batteries, so the normal batteries that you use for your TV pile, TV remote or whatever, really, they have too small current to actually power your robot. So they are out right away. The rechargeable ones. Where is this robot? There you go. Oh, gosh. Like here. They are fine. They have pretty large current. They have pretty large capacity too. But they are very heavy because they are mostly metal. They are hybrid metal batteries. So the best solution you can have is the recent development that is loved by all the remote controlled planes and helicopters community. It's the lithium polymer batteries. And also lithium batteries generally, the ones you have in your cell phones, the ones you have in your tablets, the ones you have in your laptops often. Those are the same type of batteries. They are light and they have very large capacity. Problem with them is the voltage varies a lot. So when they are fully charged, a single cell of this battery has 4.2 volts. But when you discharge them, the voltage drops very fast. And if you drop it too low, you won't be able to charge the battery again. You can throw it away because discharging it too much will damage the battery. Also, there is a fun fact about those batteries. Discharging them will damage them. That's okay, that's sad, but you can do it. Overcharging them, or shorting them, or drawing too much current from them, or damaging them physically, will also damage them in explosive way. Especially when they are charged. They will burst in flame that is impossible to extinguish and that produces toxic fumes. So handle with care. Also, the batteries in your phones, by the way. They are the same batteries. And the other downside, you need something like this to charge them. You need a special charger that has a that can regulate the voltage in special ways to charge them efficiently. Okay, and the next one. Oh, right, because the voltage varies so much, you need a voltage regulator to keep the voltage that comes into your electronics at constant value. And I won't be delving into that, but consider that in your project that you need a voltage regulator. Okay, the next one. This is what I learned. I used what I learned with Kubik in this robot. Let me put it away. You can see it's yep, turn the video on. It's much smaller than Kubik. It doesn't have a Raspberry Pi inside, obviously. They don't make them so small. And you can control it with Python through Bluetooth. I call it Micro Kubik because it's smaller than Kubik. Let me connect to it. Okay, it's not that simple. You have to know the magic word. So I will connect this thing here, or maybe here. Okay. Okay, and the idea is the same. You can move it up and down and around and walk with it. Can walk sideways. And it can turn. And it can also do this. As I said, it has the optimal size for robots, for hobby robots, in my budget at least, because if you build bigger ones, you know, the size, as the size grows linearly, the area grows to the square, and the weight of the robot grows with the cube, yeah. To the third power. So you need different materials for the legs. You need metal for the legs if it's much bigger. Here I use the servo horns that are, they actually come with the servos. The only additional element, mechanical element, is the box for the body. So you can see they are kind of wobbly. That's the whole idea. And yeah, it has an Arduino on board that's connected to the Bluetooth module and that only accepts commands from the computer that tell it, okay, move this servo to this position and this servo to that position. And that's all. All the rest is in Python on the computer. I could probably run that Python on the computer on a Raspberry Pi to be true to the title of my talk, but running it on the laptop is much easier. It's also much easier to program it this way because you can debug on your computer. You can use whatever debug techniques you like. You don't have to blink your LED on the device or whatever. Yeah, it has one. It actually has one sensor on it. Oh, I disabled it. That will take a moment then to reconnect it. Okay. You can see one of the... Oh, you cannot actually see it very well. Okay. One of the circles is the position of the accelerometer and the other one is the position of the gyroscope. It has also a temperature sensor, but I don't use that. As you can see, it's quite noisy. I will need to write some filters. Yeah, I need to write some filters to actually make use of it. I don't make any use of them right now, but I have some ideas. Like I can use it to check if the leg actually hits the table or if there is a end of the table and it would fall down. Because I can move the leg a little bit farther down and see if the robot is tilting, right? Yeah, I have a whole range of interesting behaviors that I'm planning to program into it. I can't show you any of them because I haven't yet. And I probably will fail with all of them anyways. So, but it's still a cool toy when you are controlling it remotely. Okay. It has voltage monitoring because discharging the battery over the limit will damage it. So it also monitors its own battery over an analog pin, and when it drops too low, it will shut down. Which is pretty cool, in my opinion. Okay, to actually be able to move the legs, you need to do a little bit of trigonometry, because what you are giving to the servos are the angles, but what you want to use in your programs are actually coordinates of the end of the leg, because that's much easier to program. It has to have three servos per leg to be able to move the foot into any position. And yeah, writing and debugging those equations takes some time. It's not that they are very complicated, but there are so many things you can do wrong in them. And then you have, like this one, literally tore its legs off at some point. Okay, the next room. Okay, that will need some preparation.
So, we can have quadruped mammals. A mammal, an example mammal is a sheep. This is a ship inside. Okay, let's see what it does. As you can see, mammalian configuration of the legs is also quite cool. You can put it into toys like this. Yeah, actually have a control over it because I put a remote controller, TV remote sensor. Yeah, well, maybe. Yeah. Let's go forward. It's a little bit skewed because it's not trimmed properly, but mostly works.
It's also cool for another reason. It only uses 8 servos, not 12 servos like this one, because it only needs 2 degrees of freedom per leg. Okay, I have to speed up a little bit. So, as you can see in the diagram, the length of the lever is not very that much at any point. Even if you stretch the leg maximally out, the force that on that leg is not that large, so it's quite nice. You need fewer servos. You don't need glue. Here I used some glue. Here I just used screws. And yeah, it can carry much greater payload. As I said before, walking is just pushing your body forward and then raising your feet. The feet that go out of their range to avoid tripping. So, yeah. In order to have the area of support with a four-legged robot like this, you have to have 3 legs on the floor at all times. So you can only move 1 leg at a time. That's actually not true, because you can have guides that move 2 legs at a time, but they are not statically stable and they are more complex to program. The most efficient guide that is statically stable for quadruped robot is the so-called creep guide. You move legs as is indicated there. So first the front left, then the back right, hind right, then the front right, and then the hind leg. Left in like a figure 8 shape. That gives you the best area of support at all times. And duty cycle is the time the leg actually works. So the time the leg is on the floor. And by changing the duty cycles, you can change the speed of the robot. You have to have some time. Taking the leg off floor and moving it to the new position takes some time. And that's the main limiting factor for the speed of your robot. The shorter this time is, the faster your robot can walk. Okay. TV remote, as you saw, is very simple to program, very cheap. The sensor is like 2 zlotys or a dollar. And everybody already has a remote, right? So it's a very nice way to control your robots. The last one. This one is not finished. I decided, okay, I built this one. Can I build a robot that is under 100 zloty? Totally. And this is my attempt at doing that. It doesn't do anything, actually. I can show you it, but I still haven't programmed it properly. It only has 2 degrees of freedom per leg, and it's not in a mammal configuration. So configuring the inverse kinematics of those legs, so those equations that tell you what angles to use to make the leg go into certain area, is quite difficult. Actually, it involves theory on the plane, because each leg, the allowed positions of each leg is a torus, actually. And the floor is a plane, right? Mathematical plane. So you have four tori. It's a plural for torus, not the Japanese Shinto gate. And you actually have to calculate the solution to a quadratic equation. I tried to do that with Wolfram Alpha. Wolfram Alpha said to me, go buy a subscription. Yeah, I tried to do it on paper. I don't have enough paper. So I'm going to do it experimentally with a lookup table. And that will probably be the simplest way to make it work. When I make it work, it will be very cool. It doesn't have absolutely anything in it, just an Arduino, a battery, and 8 servos. So that's the cheapest you can go with a robot. Yeah, there are other possibilities. There was a talk yesterday about hardware projects, and we had a lot of different computers and microcontrollers listed in there. I won't tell you about each of them. One thing, just when you are using a real computer like Raspberry Pi or other single board computer or even a real PC on a computer, you have to remember that what you are getting is a lot of complexity, because basically you have a data center on wheels or data center on legs. A perambulating data center. And that means that you have to upgrade the operating system of that computer. You have to be the system administrator of that computer. You have to watch over all the connections that you have inside. So it's like a data center, actually. You have different devices connected to it, sensors and so on. And it gets quite complex. If you have a simple thing like here, and all the sensors are just connected directly into the microcontroller board, and you just have some simple C program that reads the values and does something, gets much easier. So, of course, you can't do as many as fun things, and debugging this is actually quite difficult too. So it's always a trade-off. Okay. So, oops. Resources you can use. So Let's Make Robots is a forum website with a lot of people making their own robots, and they are very helpful, very nice community. They are very inspiring. So if you want to start making robots, definitely visit that website. Trozen Robotics is a little bit more professional. They make huge quadruped robots for what they call mech warfare. They put guns on them and walk around a huge city made of cardboard and shoot to each other. So quite fun. yeah, there are robotics and Arduino channels on Freenode. The people there are extremely helpful. And there is a Polish forum, Elektroda.pl. I don't actually use it, but it's it has a lot of people helping with all things electronical. So you can always ask a question in there, and that's in Polish. As for parts, if you are going for Arduino and modules or Raspberry Pi, there are three quite famous makers of designers of those parts. There is Adafruit, SparkFun, and Polulu. They are American companies mostly, and they hire a lot of very smart, very good people who design those electronics for you. But they have to pay those people, and they have to pay them for reading documentation and so on. So usually those parts are quite expensive, plus shipping from United States gets expensive too. So there is an alternative, and that's the Chinese. The Chinese like shop pages. Hobby King is a radio controlled hobby toys website where you can buy servos and batteries. All the rest of them is like eBay or Allegro, just for the Chinese, where you can buy things like, I don't know, this board here, this is an Arduino board, only smaller than Arduino Uno. It's Arduino Pro Mini, it costs like $2. This servo cord costs like $1.50 on the Chinese website. What you have to remember is that they are taking those open source designs that those smart people made, and they are making mass producing those and selling them for cheap. So if you can, and if you can afford that, support the original companies that produce them. But if you just want to start making stuff and you don't really have money for extra things, the Chinese stuff actually works quite fine. And you can contribute to the community in other ways, right? Doesn't have to be money. And that's all. Questions?
Hello. If I would like to make a robot that is hovering with a camera, how do I start? What do you suggest that should
so
I look
you
at?
Would like to have a quadcopter, right? Well, I would start with finding a forum where people make those and asking them.
Okay.
Yeah, basically, whatever you are starting to make, somebody on the internet have attempted that before you, and they are going to help. They have some tutorials, documentation, and stuff like that. I know that the equations for keeping it in place and controlling it are quite difficult. Actually, there is a course on MIT right now that you can subscribe to remotely online. You can watch it online. That's called Underactuated Robotics.
Okay.
And they teach you about controlling stuff like that.
Thanks.
It's complex stuff. It's like differential equations and stuff like this. But they explain it very well. And it's MIT, so yeah.
From what you said, I gathered that you just started right away with legged robots, okay? So did it ever occur to you that making a wheeled robot would be a lot easier?
Yes, it did. Actually, I tried to make a wheeled robot and I never could get it right. I guess it has to be hard for me to actually start, making progress. Wheeled robots are much, much easier. If you just want something that goes around your room and avoids obstacles or follows light or whatever, wheeled robots are much, much easier. Also, if you want something with a camera, for example, for a spy robot or something like that, wheels are great, trucks are also great, and stuff like that. Don't go for legs. Legs are challenged in themselves. Okay, yeah. So don't come here. So for the most active people, I'm supposed to give from the Raspberry Pi kits from the sponsor. So. Here you go. Okay.
How long did it take you to build your first robot? Or
the first one is this one. And it took like 2 weeks, maybe 4 hours a day.
And with the next robot, the time it is shorter.
Yes, this
or
one
longer?
Was 8 hours, like 2 days. So I knew what I wanted to do. Also, there is the time for waiting for parts, but I don't count that, right? Because you usually work on it, then you realize that oh no, I need some additional parts. You order them, then 3 weeks later you get them and you continue. So.
Okay, that's going to be actually two questions and one suggestion. You use Arduino, and we saw you switch with from Raspberry Pi to Arduino because the size issue. And you use which one Arduino? Arduino Uno, Arduino Nano?
Arduino Pro Mini.
Pro Mini, okay. I'm going to suggest something like DigiSpark, which is a lot smaller and a lot cheaper than Arduino, and also not so much.
Also doesn't have enough pins to... to control 12
yes,
servos.
But you can use multiplexer and to
yes, that's
extend.
Another part that you have to add to.
Yes, it's, but it's yes, sure. Also the cheaper way and the smaller way.
Well, the, as I said, this costs $2.
Okay, that's but still you can use Admega or at Tiny and still
yes, at Tiny is like 8 zlotys or something like that.
So four.
4 zlotys.
Four
okay.
Zlotys.
Yes, yeah. And but I will have to make a board for it, right?
Still, it's very cheap. Or you can make a breadboard and use it many, many times. So it's still a very, very fine idea. And I want to suggest, because this is still making programming at Mega or at Tiny or something like this, it's still very, very cheap, than cheaper than Arduino, using the Arduino. So this is probably going to be the best way, because we want to issue. You have to be less than 100 zlotys. This is something
well,
like...
Actually, Arduino is at Mega. It's the same CPU, right? It's the same microcontroller.
Yes, but...
It just has an additional regulator on the board, and that's
yeah,
all.
Yeah, and pretty much two at Mega, because this one is making the USB and stuff like
no,
that.
No, the second one is FTDI, actually, and this one doesn't have it.
Okay, but...
By the way.
We know what we're doing, sure. But I'm gonna suggest you using smaller one or even programming at Mega. But if you already know that,
yeah, sure.
So
thank you.
Thanks.
Any more questions?
Don't be shy.
Which Python modules do you use, or are you writing stuff from the scratch?
So. I realized at some point that animating a robot is a lot like animating animations in games. That's why I use Pygame. I already know Pygame. I wrote some games before, so I already have like this a couple of tricks up my sleeve for animating things. And just instead of bleeding them on the screen, you just send them to the servos. But everything else is basically the same as animating games. You also have to respond to controller, to the sensors and so on. So I use Pygame. I use Serial library, obviously, because I talk through Serial with the Arduino. I think that's it, actually. I should be using NumPy for all the calculations, for all the vectors and so on. But I didn't get there yet. So far I'm just using trigonometric functions, like in a row form. I'm going to use NumPy sooner or later, though. So.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Any more questions?
Do you need like some big electronical skills to start, or just the basics with the knowledge from the internet is enough to start?
So you need at the basic, the very basic stuff, like making your stuffed toy move or something like that. You don't need any skills, you just use a breadboard, stick those things into the breadboard, use some cables to connect it, and that's all. You can follow the tutorials on Adafruit. They have some very nice tutorials for beginners projects. To make something like this, you need to have at least minimal soldering skills, because you have to, let me show you, you need to connect the servos somehow, and to do it, the servo plug, I have a servo like, ouch, I have a servo here, and it has a plug like this, right? There are three wires in there. Two of them are for power, and one is for controlling it. So you have to plug it into the Arduino somehow. And Arduino looks like this. It has pins for output on it. And to plug it, normally you would... use cables like this with plugs on the end of them and connect them. That's easy, right? You don't need any soldering skills or anything like that. But to connect servo, you need to also provide power. So I make a board like this with the additional power pins. Electrically, it's very simple, right? I made it from a ready printed circuit board that only has vertical strips on it. And yeah, this way. I put it here inside, then I can plug the servo this side, this way. I can plug the servo this way then. Right, so you need at least basic soldering skills for making this board. Then you can plug everything you want. You just, sometimes you will need to solder some additional plugs to the sensors that you are using or to whatever you are using. But mostly you are just plugging things.
Okay, the last question. Is it dangerous for, I don't know how to call it, for the Raspberry, let's say the Raspberry to...
Oh yes. So this robot has a, its second Raspberry Pi on, inside.
It's easy to damage it from.
Yes. The thing is, Raspberry Pi, Arduino's pins are 5 volt, and the Raspberry Pi's pins are 3.3 volts, and they tell you, okay, they are not. It's not safe to use 5 volts on them, and I ignored that. And I connected, it uses a servo controller board inside, not an Arduino, but a similar thing that goes at 5 volts. I ignored that. I connected this to the serial to Raspberry Pi. It worked for a month. After a month, the GPIO pins stopped working. So I replaced it with another Raspberry Pi that I had as a home server, because I didn't need GPIO pins on the home server, right? And so far it's working still. I didn't fix it. Actually, you have level converters for that. You can use that, and they will convert from 3.3 volt to 5 volt and the other way. But I was too impatient to wait for them to arrive, so I didn't use them. This one somehow doesn't burn. I guess I'm lucky this time. And yeah, and the thing is that home server stopped working after another month completely. So the damage probably was something more than just GPIO pins, and it just took some time to catch up.
Okay, so thank you.
Also the batteries. I already told you about the batteries, right? Okay, I have to finish now, so thank you everybody.